And in this session, we have our speaker, Guillaume Salbreux. Guillaume is currently the Francis Crick Institute in London, UK. Before that, he has been in Dresden in Max Planck PKS. Guillaume is working on tissue morphogenesis. Guillaume.
Thanks for the introduction, and thanks a lot to the organizers for the invitation. The meeting is great, and I'm learning a lot.
Yes, can do that.
Is it better? Sort of. And now? Yes, I can speak louder, maybe. Okay, so I moved recently to the Francis Crick Institute. Before, I was in the Max Planck in Dresden, and most of the work that I'm going to show has been done there. I'm going to talk about the physics of tissue morphogenesis, and the general interest that we have is on flows and motion that occur during embryogenesis. And these movies are a few examples of the massive cellular flows that occur in the development of organisms. This is a movie in zebrafish, and those are three movies in the development of Drosophila. This is zebrafish epiboli, which involves the expansion of a tissue over a spherical yolk cell, and you can recognize the cell outlines and how the cells deform in order to cover the yolk cell. This is a Drosophila dorsal closure, and there is a tissue here, the amniocerosa, that constricts and finally entirely disappears and allows the two epithelial tissue on the side to seal. This is thorax morphogenesis, also in Drosophila, which involves anisotropic motion of convergence and extension in a tissue. And this is gastrulation, so as was pointed out before, this is one of the first events in the development of Drosophila, which involve a change of the topology of the embryo. And for that, it requires the tissue to deform in three dimensions and to fold. And here we see a cross-section along the anterior-posterior axis of the embryo. And we see how this epithelium here folds in order to move some of the cells which are on the surface inside the embryo. So all these processes occur on the timescale of several hours. They involve thousands of cells, and they must occur in a coordinate way in order to establish the correct shape of the organism at the end of development. So it is really essential to understand how this occurs and how the cells manage to exert forces in a way that they generate the correct flow and obtain the correct shape over the course of embryogenesis. So how do they do this? So they do this through cellular structures that generate forces. This is a schematic that illustrates this. So the cells can assemble in epithelium, which are basically a single cell thick tissue. And they then attach to each other by proteins such as cadherins, which establish mechanical links between cells. And then inside each cell, there are elements of the cytoskeleton, so filament and motors, that are responsible for generating forces inside the cell. And so what happens is that motors bind to filaments, they then exert force on the filament, and by exerting relative forces, they exert forces at the scale of the cell. Then these forces are transmitted from cell to cell, and eventually they are transmitted at the scale of the tissue. From a physical point of view, okay, so one thing first is that this, of course, involves many different scales, from the scales of a molecule to the scale of a tissue. So it's really a problem of physics because we have a microscopic scale, we have a macroscopic scale, and we want to obtain physical theory that will allow us to connect them. Okay, this is something that physics is good at. The other interesting thing from a physical point of view is that those are examples of active matter, which has been flourishing over the last 15 years as an area of physics where new phenomena could be described. What does it mean that it's active matter? It means that the system works out of equilibrium, but not because you impose through external boundary conditions at the surface of the material, you impose some external constraints, Rather, it's out of equilibrium because at the macroscopic level, the system is capable, is using energy and function out of equilibrium, even at the local scale. And in the case of the cytoskeleton, this occurs, for instance, through this myosin, through these molecular motors that hydrolyze ATP, and they use the energy of ATP hydrolysis to exert forces. And this is what makes this system work out of equilibrium. And so the fact that these biological systems are active give rise to an original physics, and this is something that we also want to understand. So now to come back to epithelium, we want to have a physical theory to that's going to describe the mechanics of epithelium. And also over the last 10 years, maybe, the high descriptions of this epithelia have arisen from observations that if you look at a tissue and you look at it from the top, so okay, so tissue have apico-basal polarity, and most of the cytoskeleton is located on the apical side, then you can image from the top and look at what the tissue looks like apically. And this is what you see. You see basically a network of bonds, and bonds are junctions between cells. And if you take a laser and you do a laser ablation of one of these bonds, what you see is that it recoils. This is visible here. And so this indicates that this bond is under mechanical tension. So based on these ideas, there has been the development of vertex models. The idea of vertex model is to say that what we are going to keep of this complicated three-dimensional structure is only a two-dimensional view, where the bonds between cells are represented by line, and when several cells meet with each other in one point, it corresponds to one vertex. And it is then enough to describe the motion of the vertices in order to describe the shape changes of the tissue. So it's a very economic way of describing the mechanics and shape change of an epithelium. Now, how do the vertices move? You need to say something about the mechanics of the system, and one of the simplest versions of this model is to say that there is an effective energy, and that's going to say how these vertices move. And this effective energy has two terms. The first one says that the area of cell is constrained with some elastic modulus, so that the area of the cells do not vary too much. The second term corresponds to a line tension that's associated to each of these edges. So this term gamma aj is a tension here. And so essentially, you end up having a network of bonds that are under tension. And then the force acting on each vertex is calculated by differentiating this energy with respect to the position of one vertex. So one can use this model to ask a number of questions. This has been done, for instance, to explore in a tissue what can be the distribution of number of edges of cells, or when you have different line tension in different regions of the tissue, what kind of shape you obtain. And just to give an example, this is something we are looking at with a collaboration with Busbaum, where we are looking at a tissue which does not do any morphogenesis, but still fluctuates. And it's quite striking, actually, how the cell strongly fluctuates in time. And you can do a similar, we try to analyze what happens in this experimental system by taking this vertex model, adding some source of noise, and look at the corresponding fluctuation of vertices and try to compare with experiments and learn something about what is going on by the use of this vertex model. So vertex models are really useful to ask questions about the detailed shape of cells inside the tissue. But for today, I want to ask a different questions. I describe these vertex models to give an idea of what the mechanics of cells look like at the scale of a cell. But the question I want to ask is rather, what kind of theory can we have that's going to describe the tissue on large scale, on a scale much larger than a cell? So I want to do hydrodynamics of epithelia, but hydrodynamics in the sense of describing a system on a very large spatial scale and slow time scale. So the idea is that we want to have a theory that's not going to describe every cell, but that's going to retain all the important information at the cell scale, to have a continuum coarse grain theory. Yes? in the okay, can you? Yes. So hexagonal, you mean in the regular hexagons?
That's right.
Well, you can do this, yes. So okay, if you take a regular hexagonal pattern that you describe with the vertex model, you can go in the hydrodynamic limit, and then you get an elastic. And you can calculate the elastic modulus according to the parameters of the vertex model. But here I'm interested in not only in hexagonal packings, but in disordered packings, and in disordered packings where cells can rearrange. So, okay, I'm going to describe what we do, but we don't do exact calculation going from the macroscopic to macroscopic. We directly look at the macroscopic equation. Okay, I'm going to explain. Okay, so we want to derive this coarse grain theory. And retain the important information at the tissue scale. And one question that's going to appear when we do this is if you take a piece of tissue and you follow it over the course of morphogenesis and you see that this piece of tissue has deformed, this is illustrated here by the deformation of the contour of this yellow box, you can ask yourself, if I take a cell inside the tissue, did it deform in the same way as the entire tissue, or did it undergo a different deformation? And what is general is the relation between cell deformation and tissue deformation? That's the question I want to ask. So to answer these questions, we have worked in a collaboration with Frank Julicher and Susan Eaton. Amita Bamarco and Mathias were the PhD and postdocs we supervised with Frank, and Raphael Etourné has done all the experiments I'm going to show. So the experimental system we look at is the pupil wing. And this shows the evolution during the 16 hours of morphogenesis of the pupil wing. And you can see that the wing is made of two tissues, the hinge and the blade. And over the course of these 16 hours, it deforms from a roughly rectangular shape into a final shape that very much looks like the actual shape of the final wing of the fly. Yeah, and this is a movie of this process over this time course. And one can see that this involves massive cellular flows. There is a big region of cell contraction on the left and a region of cell elongation or tissue elongation on the right. So when you look at this movie, you think, okay, the way it works is relatively straightforward. You have the hinge here appears to contract. The blade appears to elongate. So the most basic thing you can think is because of hinge contraction, it pulls on the blade, therefore the blade is elongating. And if you were looking at the detailed shape of cells inside the blade, you might expect that each of these cells elongate at the same time as the tissue does. So the question is whether this picture is correct or whether more complicated things are happening. So to look at this more precisely, we need to look at cells. And so what Raphael has done is taking these movies and then segmenting them, which is a huge work because at the end of the process, there are 10,000 cells. And after segmentation, it tracks them. So this is now a view of the same movie as before, but now it's a computer version of it, where each of this line is a recorded version of a binarized version of the cell interfaces. And then it puts all this data in a database, which contain the cell position over time and other information such as the neighbor relationships between the cells, when these neighbor relationships are changing, and events such as cell division or cell disappearance over the course of this movie. So now what we do is obtain this data, and we want to do something with it that's going to tell us something about what's going on. So what do we analyze? So the first simple thing is to extract a velocity field from it, and this is simple. You take the center of each cell, you look at where the center is in the next frame, and that defines the velocity field. Now, the velocity field is not necessarily the most interesting thing. When we are interested in tissue deformation, it's interesting to look rather than at the velocity field, at gradients of the velocity field or at shear. because gradients of velocity field inform about how the tissue is deforming. So if initially you have a square piece of tissue, you wait in the next frame and you calculate this gradient of deformation, and it tells you what is the shape of the rectangle that this square has moved into. And in particular, the tissue shape change are characterized by the shear. The rate of tissue shape change is characterized by the shear, but the tissue shape change itself is characterized by the time integral of the shear. So to illustrate this, if you take a box, you elongate the box, the amount of elongation that you have in the tissue is the time integral of Vxx, the x component of the shear. Okay, so shear is the information that we need to describe tissue shape change. Now we, this is a movie illustrating what the shear is. So here the wing has been decomposed into little square, and in each square you can calculate the shear, and you can represent it by we can take the traceless part of the shear. The traceless part of the shear is can be represented by a line because it has a direction and a magnitude. And you can then plot this over time. And you see there is a pattern. There is some special variation to it. But it doesn't, it's clear that it doesn't vary too much over space. And most of the shear inside the blade is oriented along the anterior-posterior direction, which is the horizontal axis in this movie. This is about shear, but we also want to describe cell shape. So how do we describe cell shape? Basically, we want to look at each of these cells, and we want to say, yes?
On the left half of the wing, right? So it's really something which is sort of being pulled? Is that?
At long time, sorry?
So if you look at the long time limit, The lines become longer only on the left half, and the right half it becomes very, very small.
Yes, it's true that there is a gradient of velocity. It kind of decays exponentially from here to here, and it's true that the velocity appears to change. So I mean, one way we can understand this is if there is a friction between the tissue and the external material that creates this kind of profile. As you will see later, we have mostly looked at averages over the entire blade rather than a detailed profile. But it's true that there is a velocity profile which decays away from the interface, inch blade interface, towards the tip of the blade. And probably it's the hydrodynamic length, the ratio of viscosity and friction, that creates this decay. Is there a wing flow?
A mean flow?
So in principle, there is a fixed point here, there is a fixed point here. So in that sense, no. But it happens in some movies that the fixed point is on the left. So if you do the average, strictly speaking, you will find a flow on the left. But the left part of the hinge is fixed, and this point is fixed as well. Yes.
So with respect to this movie, at the very end, you see sort of densities along the long axis. Are these the so-called veins of the wing?
Yes, those are the veins. They form during this process. They are made of slightly smaller cells, which is why they appear brighter.
Okay.
And we haven't looked at them closely. But yes, those are the veins.
And eventually, sorry, maybe you'll talk about it, but do they differentiate, or
do they
just remain just small cells and that's it? I mean, it's okay, maybe.
So, I mean, they are different because they get smaller. I don't know if it's exactly known how they become different. I don't know if one can say that they differentiate or if it's just some signaling that makes them different. I'm not sure. So coming back to cell shape. So we look at these cells, and then we want to know when we look at these cells whether they are round or whether they are elongated. So there are several ways of doing this. For instance, you could take one of these cells and you could fit an ellipse, and then you take the main axis of the ellipse, you calculate the elongation of the ellipse, and that gives an idea of the cell elongation. But here, for reasons that will become clear later, we have chosen a different way of doing it. We define a dual network, which connect the centers of nearest neighbor, of cells that are nearest neighbor. Then you get a network of triangles. And you can look at each of these triangles and ask how elongated the triangle is. This has the big advantage that it's easy to answer this because triangles are simplex in 2D. So there is a single affine transformation that allows to connect the shape of a triangle to a reference equilateral triangle. So we can calculate this affine transformation, and then we decompose it into the product of a rotation and a deformation. So the rotation basically changes the base of the triangle, and then the deformation actually changes the shape of the triangle. This deformation, we write it as exponential q, and we define the triangle elongation tensor as being this value of q. This value can be computed for every triangle, and then we take a piece of tissue, we average the triangle elongation, and we get cell elongation tensor qij. And to illustrate this meaning with basic schematics, if the cells are isotropic, the value of this tensor is zero. If the cells elongate in one direction, it will be non-zero. And in this example, qxx is positive. And in this example, qxx is negative and qiy positive because this, the part that describes the elongation of this tensor is a traceless tensor. Okay, so now we have this quantity to describe cell elongation. And we can do the same thing, look at the field in the wing, and we see this movie. And again, each of these point corresponds to the value of cell elongation measured on a small square. And we see that like the velocity field, and even more, the deformation, cell deformation field is really homogeneous. It's really clearly oriented along the anterior-posterior axis. Okay, and we kind of see that it first increases and then decreases. So if we just look at this flow field, we see that the deformation field of the tissue and the deformation field of the cells are somewhat similar. They are both AP-oriented and relatively homogeneous. Okay, so now we want to be a bit more precise and make really quantitative comparison of these two quantities. So to do this, instead of looking at the fields, I'm going to consider quantities that are averaged over the hinge and the blade. I consider two main directions, one proximal distal direction along the x-axis. Sorry, I said anterior-posterior before, but that was not correct. It's proximal distal in that direction and anterior-posterior direction along the vertical axis. And then we can calculate the tissue shape change and decompose it into isotropic and anisotropic part. The isotropic part corresponds to the change of area, and the anisotropic part corresponds to the elongation once you have removed the area change. Sorry? Shear corresponds to this quantity, the xy shear, yeah, exactly. So there is some, but it's small, much smaller than this part. So starting from now, I neglect this. Okay, then we can do the same thing for the cell shape change. So the cell elongation is decomposed into the cell area change and a traceless tensor that describes only cell elongation. So I can decompose the shape change of tissue and cells into isotropic part, which have to do with area, and anisotropic part, which has to do with elongation. So now I'm going to discuss these two parts separately because they can be treated separately. Okay. So first question is, what is the relation between tissue area and cell area? This, in fact, is easy to answer because if you take a piece of tissue and you see that the tissue area has changed, there are two reasons for this. Either each of the cells inside the tissue has changed their areas, therefore the tissue has changed its area, or the cell area did not change, but there was some cell division, therefore you have more cells, and therefore the overall tissue area has changed. And the intermediate situation between these two extrema can be captured by a balance equation, which is exact, and says that the tissue area change is the sum of the average cell area change plus the division rate minus the delamination rate. This is quite straightforward. So now we can look at these different quantities in the wing, and we can plot either the rate, so the amount of area change per unit time on the left, or the cumulative sum, which corresponds to the total area change on the right. And this is, the black line is the tissue area change. You can see it's close to zero, both the rate and the cumulative sum, which says that in fact, the area of the blade does not change. Okay. I don't know if I said it clearly, but now I'm considering only the blade. However, there is a cell area change, so the rate is negative and the cumulative sum is decreasing, so that means that cells are becoming smaller and smaller. And there is an opposite and equal rate of cell division, which is positive, so cells divide, and there is almost no cell delamination, actually. So basically, the picture here is quite clear. What happens is that the cells are just cleaved, the tissue area is not changing, but the cell areas are dividing, and over the course of the process, cells are getting smaller and smaller. Yes? So I think the veins are already specified at the beginning of the movie. Where they start to appear, I don't know if it can be clearly defined then. But okay.
In that graph, I mean, is it in the flat region or is it in the rising region? That's all the second graph.
But how do you define appearance of veins?
No, some threshold in the intensity, something like that.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Yeah,
not sure. Because you think it's connected with cell division, or no? Okay. Do you have something in mind in this? No. Okay. Okay. So this is about tissue area. So now this was relatively straightforward. Now we can go into asking what happens with the cell anisotropic deformation. So now I'm plotting as a function of time, first the tissue elongation along the proximal distal axis, so along the horizontal axis. And this is, it is the time integral, so it tells me how much the tissue deforms in total. And over, this is a smooth curve, and over the 16 hours of development, it goes from 0 to 0.2. So it says that if I look at the blade, the area is not changing, but the blade is elongating by about 20% in that direction, compressing by about 20% perpendicular direction. Okay, and now I look at cell elongation. This is the blue curve, and I see that it's not the same curve. The cells first are isotropic, then they elongate a lot, and then the elongation is decreasing, so it goes at maximum value to 30%, and it decays to about 15%. Okay, so the cell elongation and tissue elongation are not the same thing, and the question is where does the difference come from? And the difference comes from the fact that in the same way that cell division creates a difference between tissue area and cell area, topological changes create a difference between tissue deformation and cell elongation. And what are topological changes? There are events, there are several types of them. One of them is neighbor exchange, so it's a process by which one edge in the network shrinks, so two threefold vertices turn into a fourfold vertex. Then this fourfold vertex re-expand, and so the two dark blue cells lose a contact, the two pale blue cells win a contact, and so in this process, cells can progressively change their neighbors. And the two other topological changes that exist in the tissue are cell division, which corresponds to the creation of a new bond inside the network, or cell delamination, where you have the disappearance of an entire cell. So how does that exactly make a difference between... One may wonder, are these topological changes present inside the tissue? And the answer is yes. So this is a movie zooming on one part of the tissue as a slightly higher frame rate. And if you look at it for some time, you can spot some T1 transition. I think here there is one. And these T1 transitions are relatively frequent. There is one transition per cell per hour. That means over the 16 hours of development, each cell undergoes about 16 T1 transitions. So there are frequent neighbor exchange inside the tissue. It's also interesting to see how strongly this tissue is also fluctuating. Okay, so how do we capture the effect of T1 transition? We capture it by writing a balance equation, which says that the tissue flow, or rather the gradient of flow, is the sum of the cell shape change and the tensor or shear created by T1 transition. Because I showed before that these quantities are not equal, and I'm seeing here that the difference between them are created by T1 transition. So what does this equation mean? To clarify this, I'm now showing a few extreme examples. Okay, sorry, first. In general, T is a tensor. Here, I'm taking quantities that are projecting along the proximal distal axis. So T becomes a scalar with a sign. the sign corresponds to the orientation of T1 transition. If T is negative, it means that I'm losing horizontal bonds. If T is positive, it means that I'm losing vertical bonds. So the average value of T gives me some information about the anisotropic orientation of T1 transition in the tissue. Okay, so now to understand this equation, I look at some extreme examples. Let's say that there is no T1 transition. Then V is equal to dq dt. This is the example of this schematic. I have the yellow box. I stretch the tissue. Each cell inside the yellow box are stretched in the same way that the entire tissue. So cell elongation is the same as tissue elongation, and these two quantities are equal. I can also have a situation where I don't have any cell elongation, but I create a tissue deformation just by rearranging the cells. That's what this example is showing. Here, the cells are hexagonal on the left and the right. They are regular hexagons, but I have rearranged them. So the pale blue cells have come into contact, and the dark blue cells have loose contacts. And by doing this, I end up elongating the tissue. Yes? It's one transition per cell per hour, roughly. No, well, okay. So, I mean, you have local T1 transition, but if you have many of them in different places of the tissue, that creates a global tissue deformation. Okay, so I'm going to show how it behaves over time. Okay. Okay, and finally, another extreme example is where you don't have any tissue deformation, but you still have T1 transition. And if you do this, you are forced to create cell elongation. So now the sum of these two quantities is zero. So you create cell elongation according to how much T1 transition you make. So this is this example. The contour of the box is not changing. There is no tissue deformation. But here, I forced T1 transition to occur. And by doing this, I'm forced to elongate the cells. So I create some cell elongation. And it turns out that what happens in the wing, as I will show, is closest to this situation where T1 transition creates cell elongation. Okay, so this was a rough explanation, but now I want to show that this can be made mathematically exact and precise. So the idea to make it precise is again to start with this triangulation, with this dual network. And then using this, one can derive an exact equation which says that the tissue shear can be decomposed into five contributions: the cell shape change, the rate of T1 transition, contribution from cell division, cell delamination, and the last term, which is here called shear by correlation, that I'm going to describe. Okay, and the important thing is that these equations are exact. You do not miss anything when you do this. If you give yourself the information of neighbor relation and position of cells, you can calculate exactly all these quantities. So I want to give some intuition from where this decomposition comes from. So first, let's consider the simplest case where there is no topological transition. And then, like I mentioned before, the tissue shape change is the same as the cell shape change. So there is an equality between these two tensors. Yes? So yeah, there is this one corresponds to, T2 transition is the same as cell delamination. So it's disappearance of one cell. It's just another name that's given to it. Okay, so here there is no topological transition. There is equality between these two quantities. But this is not exactly true because we have to take into account the fact that there are many cells and therefore there can be collective effects. And even without topological transition, you can create a difference between these two terms. This is what happened in these examples. So here the tissue shape change has not changed, but the cells are initially elongated, but in an uncoordinated way. So there is a small average elongation. But then you just rotate the cell in a coherent way in order to produce average cell elongation that is non-zero. And you can do that without changing the shape of the tissue. And to take into account this process, one needs to introduce a tensor, which we can call shear by correlation because it requires correlated motion of the cells, or disordering because it arises from ordering and disordering of the axis of elongation of the cells. Okay, and this is captured inside this tensor. Now, what about topological transition? So let's look at the T1 transition, for instance. Here you have four cells with their cell centers in green. And in the T1 transition, you lose this contact and you win this contact. In terms of a triangulation connecting the nearest neighbors, you keep the same quadrilateral here, but over the course of the T1 transition, these junctions become these junctions because these cells are neighbor, but now these cells are neighbor. So you go from these two triangles M and N to these two triangles P and Q. So in this T1 transition, you first calculate two cell elongation, which are then suddenly moved into these two other cell elongation. So overall, in this process, there is no shear of the quadrilateral. Vij is zero. There is a change of average elongation because of the change of these two axes. So in order for this equation to be valid, you need to compensate the fact that this is zero, but this is changing by a tensor. And this is what defines the tensor of T1 transition. This is how you can calculate it exactly, because you make sure that this equation is valid over this process. Okay, so this is how, from the data, we can calculate exactly the value of this tensor. And we can do similar thing for the other quantities. Then we obtain a curve in which we plot the values of all these tensors, here the projected value, as a function of time. And you have a picture for how topological changes are contributing to the overall tissue deformation over the morphogenetic process. So the yellow curve is the overall tissue deformation. And then there are many other curves. So this is a bit complicated because there are different things happening. But to keep things simple, I will now take advantage of the fact that it turns out that the sum of these three terms is about zero. And so I'm only going to discuss now the flow, the cell shape change, and the rate of T1 transition. OK, so we focus on the shear created by T1 transition. And what can we say about it? So again, this is the shear. This is the cell shape change. First positive and then negative, because initially cells are elongated, and then they are losing their elongation. And then this is, in red, the shear created by T1 transition. So it follows this characteristic curve. It's first negative and then positive, which means, because of the meaning of this tensor, that initially you have more T1 transition removing horizontal bonds. And then there is a second phase where you preferentially remove vertical bonds inside the tissue. So the next question we asked is, what controls this T1 transition? And why do we get this curve and this exchange of sign of T1 transition? So to answer this, we do something that's quite typical in a phenomenological theory. We write down a constitutive equation based on symmetry. We apply Curie principle, saying that the symmetry in the cause should reflect in the effect. And so we ask ourselves, OK, T1 transition are anisotropic. So they know something about the direction in the tissue, because you remove bonds with a preferred orientation in the tissue. So only processes that also know something about the orientation of the tissue can create T1 transition. And based on this, we derive or propose a phenomenological equation. So what's the first thing that knows about a direction in the tissue? That's the simplest thing is cell elongation, because cell elongation gives you an orientation. In other words, if you take a cell in the tissue, if it's elongated, some bonds are shorter than others. They might have, therefore, a higher probability of undergoing T1 transition. And this is captured here in this linear equation, which says that the shear of created by T1 transition is linearly proportional to cell elongation, with some coefficient of proportionality that is a phenomenological coefficient, which is unknown, which is this characteristic timescale tau. And in a passive system, such as a foam, that's all what would happen. You would just have this term, because that's the only process that can drive oriented T1 transitions. But in the tissue, it's a bit different, because it's known that there are cell planar polarity systems. So proteins are present in the tissue, and they accumulate on some edges with a coherent orientations between different cells in the tissue. So this is illustrated in this schematic. These little bars here represent proteins that sit on specific edges in the tissue in a coherent way. And then one can imagine that these proteins have an effect on the local tension of bonds, and therefore they are able to drive the preferential shrinking of some of the bonds in the tissue. And this is captured by a second term, which represents this effect of cell autonomous spontaneous T1 transition driven by a cell planar polarity system. Okay, so we propose this basic equation, which is quite simple. But because we have the data, we can test it. We have the value of T, the T1 transition, we have the value of Q, the cell elongation, and this predicts the line with an intercept which tells us how much active T1 transition there are. And when we plot the data, we see that it's not quite a line, otherwise the theory would be too simple. And rather, it looks like a spiral. So then we ask ourselves, okay, why is it a spiral and not a line? And in fact, there is a simple reason that we can propose to it, is that this equation assumes that everything is instantaneous, that as soon as you have a cell elongation, you create a T1 transition. But in the tissue, it's clear that things are not instantaneous. It takes time for the tissue to react to what happens. And this can be taken into account by introducing a delay term to the left of the equation, which corresponds to some memory, which says that there's a characteristic time of integration of the information before doing a T1 transition. And with this, we can get a spiraling curve, which looks close to the data, provided we take a delay which is quite large. It's about 4 hours. So that says that whatever process is responding to cell elongation and created T1 transition occurs on a quite slow time scale, and we don't know what it is. I just want to show that this spiraling curve is quite robust. These are different wild-type wings. Those are perturbation, either laser cuts or mutants, and all of them show the same spiraling curve, which finally stops at some point on the x-axis of the curve. Yes.
So if you go, you're saying there's a delay between Q and T, right? But if you actually go back to the data earlier, if you go back to the data where you showed V, Q, T in several plots.
This one?
Yeah, somewhere here, for example. So there doesn't seem to be a delay between Q and T. Oh, it's dQ by dT that you're plotting.
Yes. So so Q is a curve like this.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you look at Q and T, you can see that if you shift them, they match. Okay, so the other things we learned is that this coefficient that characterizes spontaneous T1 transition is negative, which means that it's horizontal bonds that are removed by cell planar polarity. Okay, and this coefficient is constant, so the picture then is that at all time you have this, the tissue is trying to make this T1 transition, which are always oriented horizontally, but at the same time, there are also T1 transitions that are triggered by cell elongation. And the other thing is that this delay between cell elongation and T1 transition, T1 transition change cell elongation because they deform the tissue, but T1 cell elongation feedback on T1 transition. And if you look at the equation, it corresponds to a damped oscillator. And then the curve of cell elongation can be understood as being the signature of this oscillator, which relaxes to its final value in an oscillating manner. Okay, and so this overshoot can be understood as arising from this delay. Okay, so that's our understanding of T1 transition in the tissue. But this is about cell shape and tissue shape, but if we want a complete theory, we also have to discuss really mechanics and flows and forces in the pupil wing. So to do that, we have to discuss tissue stress. Okay, we take a piece of tissue and we have to ask what's the stress acting on the tissue. And here again, we write a constitutive equation based on symmetry, which is more familiar to people who are familiar with active gels. So we said that the anisotropic stress has a component that's proportional to the cell deformation. So the idea is that if you elongate the cells want to restore their isotropic shapes, and therefore they exert a stress that's oriented along their axis of elongation with some elastic modulus that corresponds to the tissue elasticity. Then there are also, in addition, because there is cell planar polarity, there can also be spontaneous anisotropic stresses if the proteins exerting forces accumulate on some of the edges with some orientation. And this is characterized by this active internal stress, which also has a preferred orientation. So now we have this other mechanical equation for the stress, and we want to test it. And here we do it by taking the tissue and then performing laser ablation on regions of the tissue that are relatively large, that contain several cells. So we make a circular hole, and then it recoils, indicating that the tissue is under tension. And we can track the overall deformation of this circle into an ellipse. And we can decompose it into isotropic contribution that corresponds to the change of area of the ellipse, and an anisotropic contribution that corresponds to how much the initial circles deform into an ellipse. And this anisotropic recoil tells us something about the orientation of stresses in the tissue. Okay, and then we do that in different places in the wing. And what we do is, in each place, we measure the cell elongation. And in the same region, we measure the anisotropic recoil. And then because we expect this recoil to be proportional to the stress, we expect that this relation hold. And in fact, it does work. So those are the data of several laser ablation for wild type and a mutant. Yeah, sorry. So those are just data. This is the anisotropic recoil. This is the cell elongation. Then there is a coefficient of proportionality between sigma and V that's not known. So we cannot get K. But what we can get, so the slope of this curve is related to the elastic modulus, because this says, as you increase the cell elongation, you get more and more anisotropic stress. So this is characteristic of cell elongation. But the value of the intercept, which is non-zero, corresponds to this second term. It corresponds to this active anisotropic tension that's present even when cells are not elongated. And we cannot get each of these values, but from this analysis, we can get this ratio, because it's just the ratio of the intercept and the slope. It does not depend on the proportionality factor between sigma and V. So then we get this ratio to be about 0.3. Okay, so that then gives us reason to believe this constitutive relation. And then I just want to, then we have a theory that's complete in the sense that, given our hypothesis, we can calculate the tissue flow and cell shape change. I just want to show the equation briefly. One equation is about shear decomposition. It's about how the flow decomposes into cell shape change and other topological processes. One equation tells us how the T1 transitions are controlled in the tissue. One equation says what is the stress in the tissue. And finally, we have force balance. And then we can solve this system given some polarity field, given the rate of cell division apoptosis. We can obtain the T1 transition, the flow velocity, the cell elongation change, and the cell area. Okay, and one thing I want to point is that this theory, if you look at it on very slow time scale, you get back a fluid behavior with a viscosity, which is the product of K and tau. In other words, it's the product of this coefficient, which is the cell elasticity, and tau is the response of T1 transition to cell elongation. So this relation tells you how an elastic tissue becomes fluid through T1 transition, and it relates the viscosity of a fluid tissue to the characteristics of T1 transition. Because what happens is that if you pull on the tissue, the cell elongates, you get an elastic response. But then if you wait long enough, the cell elongation is relaxed by T1 transition, you obtain again isotropic cells, and then you can continue pulling on the tissue, and this is how it eventually becomes viscous. So this is the model, but to solve it, we need to know something about boundary conditions and know what forces are exerted externally on the tissue. And to our surprise, it turns out that the tissue is not free. In fact, there are evidence that the tissue is connected by elastic links to an external frame. So this is what this experiment is showing. So this is the wing. And here, this blue line here is the cuticle around the tissue. So it's a solid shell that the Drosophila builds around it. And here there is this dark region, and we don't know what's in there. But if we use a laser and perform a laser ablation experiment, we see that the wing retracts away from the cuticle. So that shows that there is something in this region. That shows that the wing is under tension, and that shows that this tension is sustained by elastic links connecting the wing to the external material. So what is inside this region? It turns out that the protein DMP is present there, maybe with other proteins, but at least this one is there. This is an image of this dark region I was showing before. And one see how this protein DMP appears to form a matrix that's connecting the wing, which is here, to the cuticle, which is here. So then if DMP is doing something to these links, you might expect that removing it affects the wings. And in fact, in DMP mutants, you indeed obtain misshapen wings. They have this strange shape. In fact, they are shorter than these wings. And if you look if you compare wild type and dumpy during the 16 hours of development, you see that there's a very striking difference. So this is the wild type, this is the dumpy, and the wild type stays attached at the boundary, but the dumpy retracts very strongly and is completely misshapen. So to take this into account, one more thing. So we also wanted to check that we can reproduce dumpy through mechanical perturbation. We can also do laser ablation on the distal side. And if we do this, we see that similar to dumpy, the wing is also retracting away from the cuticle. Okay. So now we take this different information into account and we make a basic model of the wing. It's very simple because we consider the shape simply by two rectangles corresponding to the hinge and blade. In other words, the things we capture are the area of the tissue and its aspect ratio. And we say, okay, we have these two wings. There is cells with some cell elongation inside these two tissues. There are internal active stresses which are different in the hinge and the blade to make sure that the hinge is contracting. And there are active T1 transitions that are oriented by planar polarity that are occurring in the blade because we have seen that they are there. And then as a response to these stresses and to this spontaneous T1 transition, the rectangles deform. They deform with some elasticity. So, okay, they deform in a way that the stresses they generate are balanced. So the stress generated by the hinge and the blade balance at the hinge-blade interface. And the stress generated at the boundary are resisted by elastic links, which represent this matrix of dumpy proteins. There is some elasticity to these links. Okay, and by writing this force balance equation, we have the system of equation that we can completely solve for the shape of these rectangles. And we do this for wild type, but also for perturbed condition. And we discuss perturbed condition by changing the elastic moduli of these links, either at the distal boundary, where we remove the attachment, or at the anterior boundary, where we remove the attachment there. Okay, and then we take our data. Okay, so this is wild type, anterior cut, distal cut, dumpy. So for each of these wings, we have taken them, analyzed the shape of cells, and then we plot these different quantities, the cell elongation, the rate of T1 transition, and the amount of tissue elongation. And we have 15 independent curves corresponding to these quantities calculated in the hinge and blade. And then we take our theory and we fit all these curves simultaneously, trying to keep the same parameters. And in the end, we have 8 parameters, so we have a lot of parameters. We also have a lot of information that constrains the model. And to illustrate what the results of the model, I just represent these two rectangles on top of the initial of the shape of the wings. So of course, it's pretty coarse because we don't describe the fine shape. We just describe it through rectangles. But still, it's nice that in these different situations, we can capture roughly what the wings are doing. And we can also capture the which is not shown here, we can also capture the change of cell elongation in the tissue. So from this analysis, we have a list of parameters. I'm not going to go through all of it, but what we learn is that the internal tissue active and elastic stress are comparable in magnitude. And the extracellular elasticity is large compared to the tissue elastic modulus, which makes sense because you see that if you cut the elastic modulus, you get a huge if you cut the external links, you get a huge tissue deformation. So that indicates that the stresses generated by the tissue are largely resisted by these bonds that are present around the tissue. And so that says that these bonds are really essential to set the correct shape of the wing. It's not really the wing that's creating its own shape by itself, it's creating its shape by exerting stresses against this external material. The other interesting thing that I would like to point out is that if you look at these different perturbations that we have looked at, you see that the final shape of the blade changes a lot. So this is the wild type. This is the anterior cut. This is dumpy and distal cut. Here, in the anterior cut, the blade is too elongated. Here, the blade is too short. So really, if you perturbate these external links, you can completely mess up the shape of the wing. However, evolution of cell shape. Okay, so those are four curves corresponding to these four conditions, showing the cell elongation as a function of time. And the curves are different, but in the end, they end up roughly to the same final cell elongation. So that says quite remarkably that you can completely perturbate the shape of the tissue, but the tissue still manages to reach the same cell elongation. And this is particularly striking here, where instead of elongating, the tissue is compressing in that direction, but still inside the tissue, the cells are elongating still along the horizontal axis. So that indicates that there is something in the tissue that manages to establish a given cell elongation. And within our theory, we understand this from this feedback of T1 transition and cell elongation, because this equation predicts that T1 transition will happen until you reach the correct cell elongation. Okay, so the cells elongate. If they elongate too much, there is some T1 transition that restores the cell elongation. If they're not elongate enough, other T1 transition that establish the correct cell elongation. So this could be a process by which a tissue can control its cell elongation independent of the tissue shape. Okay, so to summarize, this is a picture for the pupil with morphogenesis. We have several processes occurring. The hinge constricts, and this exerts an external force that drives in part the elongation of the blade. But this does not appear in isolation. There are external elastic links that are really essential in controlling the tissue shape. And on top of this, there are internal tissue processes driving T1 transition that play a role in setting the cell shape. Okay, and so we skip this. Go to the acknowledgement. Okay, so this was the work of Marco and Amitabha, and thank my collaborator, and thank you for your attention.
So Guillaume, in the final equations, I mean, initially your equations had spatial and space and time, but in the final equations, you somehow got rid of all spatial degrees of freedom.
Yes.
That is because you assumed that every cell deforms the same same way, I see.
Yeah, so we take this, okay, we choose rectangles because that allows us to take something that's homogeneous. Yeah. So the gradient of flow is homogeneous and the cell shape is homogeneous in the model, yes. So it's only for averages.
Mutants and the dumpy cut, and have you looked at what happens to PCP?
So the classic PCP? Yeah. No.
Okay, so one doesn't know how the deformation is affecting the orientation.
Yeah, okay, it's a good question. Well, there's this earlier paper of Egui where they do a different perturbation and they see that PCP is affected. But here they didn't look. Also, I should say, I think it's probably not, so this interplanar polarity system that's controlling the mechanics, I think it's probably not PCP. Rather, it's probably fat dexus because its orientation appears more consistent with the orientation of T1 transition that we observe.
Yeah, the comment is that you got those parameters and all once. So probably you can go back and do laser cuts and look like what Arnab did to see the retraction of the tissue.
To compare our calculation for the stress to, okay, we have not done this, but yeah, that would be nice.
Be localization asymmetric in the sense that you showed that dumpy mutants in distal laser cut are sort of similar, but dumpy is yes. All around.
Yes.
Linking the apical end of the wing cells to the cuticle all around.
Yes.
So
yes.
Is there some asymmetry in either concentration or distribution?
Okay, it's a very good question. I mean, it looks like it because in dumpy mutant, you can see from okay. Get this one. Okay. So you can see that in the dumpy retracts here, but it does not retract much here. But if we do a laser cut here, it does retract. So that says that that suggests that there is not only dump P acting as a linker, and probably a dump P is the main linker that's present on the distal side, but probably not on the anterior side. So probably there are several types, and their distribution, I suppose, matter to set the shape of the wing, because the resistance of elastic links will be different in different places.
What triggers this entire process? What initiates this entire process?
So initially the wing is attached, I think, to the cuticle through other. I don't know exactly how. Okay, but then there is the links between the wing and the external material are dissolved, and this is what starts the process. So it looks like initially it's more or less mechanically frozen, and then you remove this constraint, and the morphogenesis starts.
Any other questions?
So I think Madan already asked this, but just to clarify, so in this green block, you're saying everything is same. So for example, this having these veins and all does not affect the parameters or the movement of the cells on one side to the other?
Okay, so I don't understand.
The veins that are present in this, do they have any effect in terms of the dynamics of the cells on one side versus the other side? So like cells can't go from one side of the vein to the other side?
Probably not.
So things like that, do they not matter?
Okay, so one thing I can say is if we subdivide the wing inside the vein is different. But if we subdivide the veins into regions and we compute the same quantity, they look similar. So there is not very big inhomogeneities. But still, here we consider averages, and still the veins do something because locally the cells are different. But I don't know exactly what they change.
So for example, shape deformation is not same across the length, so the bottom shrinks more and the top shrinks less as the thing goes off. So those things.
So why do you need the T1 transitions instead of just elongating all the cells?
Well, I think it's because it allows, okay, this is speculation, but based on this argument, this result, based on this observation that the final cell shape doesn't change, for me that suggests that they are here in order to set the final cell elongation independent of the mechanics of the entire tissue. So this way you have two knobs, one knob to control the tissue, one knob to control the cell elongation, and they can be tuned independently. That could be one reason.
Any more questions? Okay, if there are no more questions, let's thank Guillaume once more. We'll break for lunch and assemble back at 2:15.